morning, everyone. Happy first Sunday in November. Thank you for joining us today as we begin with our call to worship. So David praised the Lord in front of all the people. He said, "Honor and thanks be to you, O Lord God of Israel, our Father, forever and ever. O Lord, you have great power, shining greatness and strength. Yes, everything in heaven and on earth belongs to you. You are the King, O Lord, and you are honored as head over all. Both riches and honor come from you. You rule over all. Power and strength are in your hand. The power is in your hand to make great and to give strength to all. So now, our God, we thank you. We praise your great and honored name." And this comes from 1 Chronicles.
Thank you, boy. You're the only Jesus some will ever see. What a good way to start our service. And I'd like to just take just a quick thing here and welcome Hoy Leong as our pianist for the church. He was voted on last week. We are so happy to have him. So happy. And I also want Joe to stand up because there's another Leong in our presence. That's your husband. Many of you have met Joe because he's been in the Sunday school classes and he's been faithful in worship during this time with Hoy. So we just welcome both of you. We're so excited that you're here. And I want to make one quick announcement about the nursery. If you're planning to take your babies to the nursery, you'll wait till after the choir anthem this morning to take them. Okay? After the choir anthem to take them to the nursery. Now, where were we? Let's worship. Lavish love, abundant beauty. This is one of my favorite hymns. Please pay attention to the words as you sing it from your heart. Stand, please.
Oh,
Let us pray. Lord God, we give you honor, power, and glory. As we enter into the beginning of what we know as the Thanksgiving season, which is truly a lifetime to celebrate, but we know during the month of November and December, we truly give thanks, Lord, for so many things that you've put into our life. We thank you for the lavish love you give us each and every day, waking us up, putting us in the right mind, enabling us to share and worship together. We're grateful, Lord, for the message that Pastor Emmitt brings, the songs from Cheryl and the praise team of the choir, the blessings of so many people in our congregation and church home that make us a church family. We know, Lord, it's not about just sitting in the pew, it's about being involved and active, and we're thankful to have so many people in our church who have stepped forward and maybe soon will step forward to answer your call to be of service. We thank you, Lord, for simple things, for large things, for everything in between, for just being around us, within us, among us, and by our side every single moment. And Lord, we're grateful to be here today to celebrate, to worship, to love, to gather, to be together as one body in Christ. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. We know those two words may not mean a lot, but to us they mean everything, because without you, Lord, we would be nothing. We would not be here. And we're just so thankful that this season we can be reminded of all the times throughout the year of just why you are so important in our lives, why each of us is so important to us, and why together as one community, as a church body in Christ, we can serve the community, we can serve each other, and we can serve our nation. So thank you, Lord, for the spirit and the soul that you've given each of us to show you just how much we love you. And as we think about how much we love you, Lord, and we're grateful for many things, including the Lord's prayer that you gave us, we say together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Hills Baptist Church and friends, welcome this Sunday as we worship here together. Got a couple of things that we are going to do today as we continue in worship. The first is to remind us of our attendance slip, which is always helpful for us. And I also want to make just a little bit of an emphasis here at the Wednesday night meal. We are still working out getting the number of meals exactly right. And so if you believe that you're going to be here on Wednesday night, please, please, please mark that you'll be here. We will always make a few extra meals, but we don't want to have too many extra meals, and we certainly don't want to have too few meals. So we're trying to find that perfect sweet spot. So if you believe that you'll be in attendance, or if you're not quite sure, go ahead and feel that you'll be here so that we can have the appropriate number of meals there. There's also an opportunity for you to share with us if any prayer needs and things like that. A couple of other announcements I want to draw out. We have two deadlines. One is Wednesday, November 9th, so that is quickly coming, where you are able to give gift cards towards our Thanksgiving meals. We've partnered with Rainbow Ministries, and this is an opportunity to ensure that everyone has their fill of food for Thanksgiving. And so there's a deadline there. Please give. You can give Easy Tithe and other methods as well. And then also November 13th, where that will be the last day. So basically, this is the last week to fill our shoeboxes for Operation Christmas Child. And so no later than next Sunday, November 13th, we would like to have those in. And you can see the other details there on the back of our worship guide. Plenty of other things that are happening in the life of our ministry and our monthly newsletter as well. And so I think that's what I have here. So I'm thinking we're doing pretty good. One other thing, later on in worship, there will be an opportunity for us as a church to reflect on a question written on this generosity question card. I'm bringing it to your attention now because it's in your worship guide, and you have an opportunity, if you wanted to read the question and even be thinking about it now. And we will return back to it later on in worship.
Good morning.
Good morning.
My relationship with this church began in 1968 when my dad accepted the call to become the senior pastor. My brothers and I grew up here. Both of my brothers were ordained in Christian ministry right here in this church. My brother Joel was the associate minister here and later served as the senior pastor for a total of almost 30 years. My grandparents attended, three of them. And my mother attended and served until June when she passed away at age 95. My siblings and I each met our spouses here. We were married here. Most of our children were dedicated, baptized, and also married right here in this sanctuary. We've held numerous family celebrations and funerals at Montgomery Hills. And needless to say, Montgomery Hills has held many, many memories for our family. It's a place where we have been nurtured and loved and been provided many opportunities to belong, grow, serve, and practice generous living. Next month, our church will be celebrating its 110th anniversary. Throughout the past 110 years of ministry at Montgomery Hills Baptist Church, much has been said and done in regards to generosity. There are so many significant events, remembrances, and ministries that took place throughout each decade. I'm grateful for the pastors and associate pastors, staff, lay leaders, members, and friends who have helped to make generosity a priority for 110 years. Why give? In 1912, in the area of Petworth, D.C., it was voted to purchase land for the building of a Baptist church. 45 people attended a meeting in a rented building, and at this meeting it was decided to establish a permanent organization with 56 constituent members. One of the members, Reverend Quirnoff Harlan, was the acting pastor until a permanent pastor could be secured. Under the leadership of Reverend Owen Lloyd, the new building was officially dedicated on June 7, 1914, at a cost of $17,500. During Paul Langhorne's pastorate, a sanctuary at that location was built in 1923, and the sanctuary building cost approximately $70,000, and its beauty was enhanced with that of a pipe organ for an additional $7,000. The membership continued to grow. In the 20s, during the pastorate of Reverend Henry Smith, it was hard to get materials from the Pennsylvania quarries and steel mills, so some of the men of the church often brought materials back in their cars to keep the building program on schedule. Now there's an example of generosity in action. The church membership grew to 880, and the debt on the building was paid. During the 30s, with the Depression, people continued to give as they were able. But generosity of one's time and talents was also very important and critical to the church's ministry and growth. A men's Bible study was established in 1929 under the leadership of Mr. Yaden. The class grew from 30 to 120. The class was in existence until around 2018. In the 40s, a unified budget was created and said to be one of the most progressive steps the church had ever taken. The financial secretary at the time, Horace Peck, said that many of the giving envelopes were not being used. He said, "We must have your assistance if the church is to make the progress we hoped for it." The weekly budget was $192.31. Hard to imagine. With monetary donations and war bonds, the church was able to raise the money, most of the money, of the $45,000 needed to build an education building under the leadership of Reverend James Rogers. The membership rose to 1,000. In the 50s, under the leadership of Reverend Lewis Morgan, October was set aside for a stewardship crusade. Reverend Morgan said that stewardship represented a twofold responsibility, that of service and of money. By 1957, the church decided to expand to the suburbs, where many of its members were beginning to move. They purchased land and began building the new building here on Georgia Avenue and Forest Glen Road. They met in a rented house until the building was complete. The fellowship hall was built first and temporarily used as a sanctuary, and the classrooms were above and below for all ages. Including land and furnishings, the church was built at a cost of $175,000. Parking was never going to be an issue because Georgia Avenue was a two-lane country road, and you could park on both sides, so lots of parking. In the 60s, people were still meeting for church in two locations. The membership was at 846. 532 people were still attending at the Petworth location, and 314 were attending at this location. In 1963, the church began meeting together as a single congregation at Montgomery Hills. This was a happening place. A forward program was implemented consisting of a budget planning committee, a budget promotion committee, a budget pledging committee. Montgomery Hills included mission in its budget and gave 14% of it to missions. By the 70s, pledge cards were used for the first time. Giving and attendance were significantly higher. And as pastor at the time, my dad, Dr. George Hawthorne, said that giving is the most significant thing a man or woman can do. Generosity is the essence of the Christian faith, because happiness and blessedness are the byproduct of giving. Giving is the heart of God. It is not just a way of raising money, it is a way of raising men and women. During that time, Montgomery Hills helped to begin a new Korean Baptist church. They worshiped with us and we shepherded and mentored them. By the 80s, Loyalty Sunday was implemented. Reverend Donnell Harris reminded us to think about all that God has given us, and especially the gift of sacrificial love that we have received in Jesus. In response to that love, he encouraged us to bring to the Lord the heartfelt commitment of our time, our talents, and our treasures. The mortgage on the debt of the church at this location was paid in 1982, and a mortgage burning ceremony was held in this sanctuary, right here, with charter members in attendance. By the mid-90s, the church budget reached almost $250,000. The ministry and mission of the church continued to grow. In the 2000s, Consecration Sunday was implemented with a guest speaker, a catered luncheon, and the use of commitment cards. We experienced a 19% increase in giving. At that time, as pastor, my brother, Reverend Joel Hawthorne, said that we should give out of gratitude to God for the blessings we enjoy in life. We should give because we have a deep spiritual need to give. We should give because our ministry together represents our best opportunity to make a difference in the lives of people today. True stewardship doesn't begin with what we put in the offering plate. It begins when we totally give ourselves to Jesus Christ. An elevator, handicap accessibility, and building renovations were completed at a cost of over $400,000. With a pledge drive, monetary gifts, and a loan, by 2012, that debt was paid in full. Ministries such as Rise Against Hunger, meeting the needs of 9/11, and the discovery of our gifts and talents and using them in ministry in and especially outside of the church became the mission focus. This church has a glorious past, no question. But I believe it has an equally bright future. Even after a pandemic, God has blessed us with a new minister. Reverend Drumgoole has reminded us that generosity is a way of living and that we are to be grateful for the generosity of God and for the generous living that we are called into. He said, we believe all people can live a generous and abundant life to honor God and to serve their neighbor. Why do I give? My husband Chuck and I believe in generous living. We believe in generous giving. We believe in serving. Generosity doesn't happen overnight. It takes time. Like many throughout the years, Chuck and I have experienced the challenges of daily life. We have experienced the tugging on our time, the pain of suffering, illness, grief, loss, home mortgages, children, college loans, weddings, car payments, credit cards, you name it, the list goes on, as I'm sure it does for many of you. However, we continue to step out on faith each year as we fill out our generosity card and increase it. We have never been sorry. And in return, we continue to experience the joy of generosity and the blessings that come from being faithful stewards of what belongs to God and God alone. I've had the privilege of being your financial secretary for 32 years. Also, I don't match. I have seen living examples of the widow's mite, as well as examples of extravagant giving. I have been the recipient of generous giving. Most recently, I was given a gift to extend my life through organ donation. I will always be grateful to our own Kelsey Wilson for my new kidney, and to all who were tested to be a donor, and those who prayed and showed their care and their love and their support. Generosity comes in many forms, doesn't it? As you consider what generosity looks like for you, and as you think about the ways in which you can use your time and your gifts and your talents here at Montgomery Hills Baptist Church in 2023, I challenge you to share in the greatest enterprise on earth, the kingdom of God. Will the ushers please come forward? Father, we thank you for the generosity that you have showered upon us May we in turn give back to you what belongs to you and you alone. May we commit our time, our talents, and our treasures to advancing the kingdom of God. Amen.
Thank you.
We invite you now, if you'd like to follow along and open up your pew Bibles to page 796. We'll be reading in the New Testament, the book of Matthew, chapter 14, verses 13 through 21. This passage should be fairly familiar to most of you, about the feeding of the 5,000. Matthew chapter 14, verses 13 through 21. Now when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish. And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowd to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled, and they took up what was left over of the broken pieces, 12 baskets full. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Friends, join me. Seems to feel like hopelessness. You make the crooked path straight. You are God, and you are God alone. And it's with this reminder that we pray one for another, because you taught us to pray for one for another. So today we pray for John's recent cancer diagnosis. Be with him. And for Manolo and family who have asked for and continue to ask for prayers. This morning we pray for Janice and her medical concerns. They weigh heavy on her mind. And for Bernard and the hopefulness of new information that could lead to healing and restoration, we pray for him and for his doctors. And for Ricky and Jana and their upcoming surgeries, because surgeries are always scary. Be of peace and comfort to them. God, we give you praise for Helen, who we receive the result that she is getting stronger day by day. And for Grant's doctor, who in the midst of caring for Grant, has suffered a diagnosis of cancer and yet has been released from the hospital today. Be a healing to the healer, oh God. For glad tidings and the ministry they do here in our nation and our world. And also, God, we pray for comfort for the grieving family and friends of Juanita Russell, who died at the tender age of 100. What a testimony her life has been to this community and to her community in Florida. And today, oh Lord, we acknowledge those members and family members of our congregation who have served and are serving in armed forces domestically and abroad. We recognize the freedoms that we enjoy. And at the top, the freedom of speech and religion, where we may worship without hindrance. So we pray for their safety and for their protection. We also recognize the complexity of the day that we live in, oh God, as continent and nation, as city and state become ever increasingly more dependent on each other. Yes, God, we acknowledge that we sometimes fall short of what we ought to strive for. We also acknowledge the place of the church, local and global, across ocean and sea, which is to be a beacon of light and hope in our world. Yes, God, nations will fall short. And yes, God, the church will fall short. And in this we pray for your grace and your guidance. For there will be a day, God, where peace will come upon this world. When swords will be beaten into plowshares, and the Prince of Peace shall remain forever and ever. And this is our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we are in the second Sunday of our Generosity Emphasis Month. And I'll tell you, I met a man by the name of Bruce Salmon briefly. My first month serving as pastor of Montgomery Hills Baptist Church, which wasn't too far ago. Longtime members will certainly remember that name, Reverend Bruce, because he served as an associate pastor at Montgomery Hills Baptist Church in the late 70s and also the mid-80s, before receiving a call to pastor at Village Baptist Church in Bowie, Maryland. He served Village with passion and with vision until January 8th of 2000, when the building burned to the ground. One of their members was walking their dog that Saturday morning and called him and said, "Pastor Bruce, you might want to get down here. The church is on fire." The police blocked off the streets. Neighbors came out to watch this building that was so significant to their community being burned to the ground. And as the fire starts to be put out, as the building had almost nothing left, the fireman asked him, "Do you want me to go inside and get anything?" Bruce said, "Just get whatever else remains." And so he got up, the fireman walked in there and couldn't find anything except for the cross that had been on the altar. And out walks the fireman with a cross in front of him, with the smoldering ash of a building that had burned all the way down to the ground behind him. Simple. That cross was of faith and hope for their community. Bruce says that the rebuilding of that church took far longer than expected. He said it took him 34 months for them to deal, because they had to deal with insurance challenges, and they had to deal with hiring architects and getting the right permits. And then, of course, when you rebuild a building, you never rebuild it the exact same way. So he said that there was a $500,000 deficit that the insurance company would not help in the repair. They needed help, because worshiping in a firehouse for 34 months doesn't work very well when you have ministry that you're trying to do. So Reverend Bruce said that it was one of the hardest times in his ministry life. But here's how that story intersects with Montgomery Hills Baptist Church, because on Easter Sunday that year, Montgomery Hills Baptist Church decided to take up an Easter offering, $7,000, every penny of which was given to Village Church, who was trying to piece their building and their life back together. Sure, $7,000 is a small drop in the bucket for a $500,000 deficit. But it was warmly and gladly received, just as it was warmly and gladly given. And that could be the end of the story, but it's not. Because the same church, the very next year, at the same time, takes up an Easter offering, and this time takes up $6,000, all of it, again, going towards a church that's trying to piece their life and their building back together. And those gifts help them get day by day, by and by. And I love that story. I love it because it reveals two things to me. First, it reveals that God's people always have a place to participate in the restoration and healing of those in need. God's people always have a place to play, a part to play in the rebuilding and in the restoration of those who are in need. But secondly, this story reveals to me that generous living is a part of the formation of this very faith community. And rightly so. Because generous living is in the DNA of those who are Christ followers. It's a part of the DNA of what it means to be a disciple, and it's a part of the DNA of what it means to be a member or a regular attender here in this church. A generous living is not an easy thing to do, saints. And that's true, and has always been true. It's hard. It was hard for the disciples as they tried to figure out how on earth they were going to feed 5,000 people. It's difficult to live generously, but it's not impossible. And it can be cultivated. And we see that in today's miracle here, the feeding of the 5,000. It's not lost on us that this miracle was done in a wilderness. And those of us who are familiar with the biblical text would understand that the wilderness is always pictured or depicted as a place of wandering and of uncertainty, where questions about whether or not God will provide or lead is often asked. Truth of the matter is, that's where they were, in a wilderness. Those who were reading Matthew would have thought back to Jesus being in the wilderness, being tempted by Satan a few chapters prior. And here, Jesus is teaching his disciples by doing a miracle. A miracle that shows up and is the only miracle that shows up in all four Gospels. It's also one miracle that Jesus doesn't do. Jesus didn't do this miracle. The disciples do this miracle. It's the miracle that almost didn't happen. The day was long. Jesus and the disciples were looking for a place of solitude because they were grieving the death of John the Baptist, and they were just trying to get away to make it to the next day, but the crowds hungered. They hungered both physically and they hungered spiritually. They were hungry for him. And when Jesus crossed over and got out that boat, he saw hungry people and was moved with compassion. Compassion to meet the basic needs. Compassion that they would not leave with empty stomach or emptiness of spirit. And so they stood there. And he stood there, identifying how their needs could be met. And the disciples were wanting to know too, because it seemed like it would have been impossible to do that. Have you ever felt that way? The needs seem to outweigh what you have. Maybe at home. maybe as you walk out your door and look in your community, or maybe as you make your way in the parking lot or on the red line right here to Montgomery Hills Baptist Church, you may feel or sense the needs that are there. There are sometimes challenges that we have. Challenges get in the way of us being able to live as generously as we would hope and as generously as we are called to in our life. Sometimes compassion fatigue. Have you ever heard of that? Compassion fatigue. It's when you've given so much that you're tired. That's what they experienced here. They had poured out so much that they were tired. It was late in the evening. That's what they were experiencing. That's one challenge for the disciples. Maybe you can relate to. How about another one? Personal responsibility. I know I should give and help, but my hunger, my problem, your hunger, your problem. Perhaps that was a challenge, a way of thinking. Or maybe it was this, and I suspect that many of us may be able to identify with this one. Perhaps it's just an underestimating the impact of their contribution. All we have a couple of loaves and fish. What can that do with over 5,000 people being hungry? That's their challenge. If we considered our own, we may be able to add to the list. But what I like about Jesus is Jesus challenges their challenge. He does that a lot, doesn't he? I think it's sometimes required of us if we're going to grow in our faith and in our maturity and following him. He challenges their challenge, and he does so partly by stepping back and inviting them to be the agents of change that would happen, the agents of giving, the agents of the miracle, so that they could witness it through their own hands. God trusts us with what we have. God trusts us with what we're given and then invites us into the work of healing and grace and restoration in community. This miracle is wonderful. It was for those who received it, but it was also for those who gave it. Because the truth of the matter is, wherever there is a sincere desire for the well-being of the recipient, wherever there is a commitment and desire to love and action, wherever there is hope for a future and an expected end, what is received will always be greater than what is given. Yes, they received food, but there was an abundance. Because it wasn't just sustenance for their bodies, but it was a reminder that God cares about their bodies. It wasn't just that they had enough strength to go on, but it was a reminder that God is the one that they can put their trust and hope in to go on. And so why do we give? We give because it reveals the miracle of the gospel. It reveals the miracle of the good news. It reveals the idea that imperfect people who are being perfected can reflect the same good news through the giving of time, and of money, and of service, and of listening, and of care that Jesus would do and is doing through his Spirit on earth today. And that's good news, saints. It's good news for us, and it's good news for our community. You know, after Reverend Bruce shared his story with me, I asked him this question. I said, beyond what the money could buy, what else did the expression of generosity mean to you and your church? And I wrote it down. Here's what his response was. He says, it was so hard. He said, I would come home after trying to hold things together because after the first year, everyone stayed together, but by the second year, he said, people started leaving. He said, 1/3 of the congregation had left. He says, I was so discouraged, all I could do was place my hands in my head. He said, but just knowing that you all were praying for us and giving toward our hope of restoration, he said, it gave the inner strength to keep going. He said, at the time, I questioned if we would make it, even to the point of thinking about resigning. He says, but it was your help that helped me stay the course and not give up and resign. And here's the thing that surprised us both. He said, had MHBC and other churches not collected an offering, he would have certainly given up. If he would have given up, he wouldn't have seen what God would do in the following years, where the diversity of his church would explode following the changing of their community. And if he would not have witnessed that, he would not have stayed until 2018. And if he would not have stayed until 2018, then the young woman, Emily Holliday, would not have succeeded him as pastor. And if she would not have succeeded him as pastor, then her and her husband Scott and their son Franklin would not have been one of the first families who I'd never met welcome me and my wife and my child to Maryland. We do not give because we know the outcome or because we know what something will come of it. We give generously believing that God is at work in our actions of compassion and love and justice. We give believing that what prayerfully comes from our hands to our church through the offering plate, through our mission efforts, through our time sitting with grieving people is making a deeper impact in the world than we will ever know. That's why we give, even as some plant and some water, and God provides. So this morning, I'm inviting you to consider a question that's on your generosity card. It's just a question. And there's a place for you to put your name at the top if you would so like, and there's a place at the bottom where if you are okay with your story being shared in some form, then you can click yes. And if you're not okay with that, that's fine. You can click no. During the hymn of response, I invite you to answer the question that's written there. Consider, when was your earliest time that you saw great generosity in giving and serving? And as you write that, and as our service ends at the end of today, I want you to drop it in the bucket in the back. It gives me a chance to read and hear the other story of generosity that are taking place, even as we're cultivating generosity as a congregation for the good of this community and our greater community. You may do that now as the hymn of response goes forth.
Give thanks to the Holy One. Give thanks. go to church. But it was a passage that was read regularly when they communed together to take of the Lord's Supper. So it's befitting for us even today. As we prepare to receive the Lord's Supper, I want us to do so in a way that is reflective over the life that we have been given, and the things that we have been given, and also our response to it. For in that is reciprocal, that even as God does, we do, and as God loves, we love. So therefore, we are reminded in the same way that the early church was reminded. But on the night in which Jesus betrayed, took the bread, he blessed it and broke it in the same way that this bread was blessed and broken. Beautiful example of continuity of story, practice that we even do today. So this morning I'm going to invite our deacons to come forward. As they come forward, they will take the elements of communion, pass it with you all, that you may receive.
Thank you.
been for us. Great generosity. Let us take it.
In like manner, Jesus took the cup, and after blessing it, he shared it with the disciples, and he said, "This is the blood of the covenant, the covenant of new and everlasting life, shed for you and for all, so that sins may be forgiven." In like manner, as Jesus shared it with the disciples, we invite you to drink it now.
Friends, at this time, I would like I would like to invite Michael to come forward. Earlier this week, Michael reached out to me and has asked and desired to join Montgomery Hills Baptist Church. And you all know Michael. And you definitely know Abigail. This is an exciting time for our church. and so, Michael, I thank you for reaching out to us. And we're going to have additional conversations and things. But we're going to try something. First of all, let me shake your hand. we're going to try something new today. On the back of your worship guide, the very, very top, on the back, there's a section that you may not have seen before. It's called Introduction and Welcome of New Member Candidates. And I want for us to respond to Michael's decision together as a faith congregation. Let us read that together. In response to your decision, we pledge ourselves to be the family of God for you in this place. We offer you our love, our care, our kinship, and our hopes. We hope to learn from you, give to you, and receive from you by God's grace. Isn't that beautiful? Let's do that together. Michael, I'm going to ask that you walk with me together as we share the benediction. Will we all rise, please? Yes. Yes. Oh, that's right. Share a little bit so I do not miss my music. Okay. Yes, we're going to bless you the top first.
Move to the outside.
One who made you and redeemed you is the one who